Now let me introduce our second leading expert in ancient Stoicism, John Sellars from King's College London. He's the author of several books on Stoicism, one of which I think is kind of self-explanatory, Stoicism. And John is going to let us through one of the most intriguing aspects of Stoic ethics, namely the theory of emotions.
Okay, thank you. Are these? Yes? Perfect. Okay. Okay, so as Gabriella just said, what I'd like to do this morning is talk a little bit about emotions. One of the central ideas in the popular reception of Stoicism. And one common popular idea about Stoicism is that the Stoics deny the value of emotions. And this might be formulated a number of different ways. That the Stoics repress their emotions, or they reject them, or they overcome them. But the shared idea behind these different ways of putting it is that the Stoics think that the emotions are not important for a good life. Indeed, not only are they not important, they are in fact an impediment to living a good life. That's a popular image. Equally common, then, is the objection that this Stoic attitude towards the emotions is deeply unattractive. And again, this objection to Stoicism might take a number of different forms. So, a healthy human life must involve a healthy emotional life, some people might argue. The emotions are an essential part of what it means to be a human being. Denying or repressing the emotions will only ever generate longer-term negative consequences for us. Emotions such as anger in the face of injustice, for instance, are valuable insofar as they can spur us on to act in positive ways, and so on and so forth. These are all objections that you'll find raised against Stoicism when Stoicism is presented as denying the emotions. Now, what I want to do now is to challenge, or at least to qualify, this way of describing the Stoic view. And my aim of, behind challenging that is, of course, to undermine those sorts of objections. My main point will be that the Stoics ought not to talk about emotions at all. Okay? Now, that isn't supposed to be a bad joke about repressing emotions. Instead, the main point I want to make is that we do a disservice to the Stoics when we talk about their attitude to emotions, because the Stoics never spoke about emotions, not in the way that we do. What do I mean by this? Well, the ancient Stoics, quite obviously, never spoke about emotions in the way that we do because they don't speak English. The ancient Stoics didn't speak English. And the English word emotion is perhaps not the best word to use to translate the Greek and Latin terms that the ancient Stoics actually did use. So my whole piece here, aimed at a popular audience, is going to be a minor technical point of translation. But I'm going to try and spin it out in a way that hopefully will make it a bit more engaging. The Stoics never spoke about emotions. They spoke about pathos in Greek, or in Latin, passio. And the English word emotion isn't quite the same. Emotion in English has a much broader notion and covers a much wider range of things. So the Oxford English Dictionary, for instance, defines it simply as a mental feeling, and then goes on to contrast it with reason. The statement that we ought to overcome our emotions, I suggest, is quite different from the statement that the Stoics make, that we ought to overcome our pathos. The Stoics did make the second statement, but not the first. Now, traditionally, in the early modern period, the terms that the Stoics used were translated not as emotion, but as passion, reflecting the Latin term passio that was often being referred to. And I think translating the key term here as passion is closer to the mark, even though it's fallen out of favour in some quarters, because nowadays passion sounds a bit archaic. But I think that's no bad thing, and it helps us to underline that we're dealing with a technical notion and not a very general and loose notion like emotion. So my first point, The Stoics don't reject emotions, they reject passions, and that's quite a different thing. Okay, so what are the differences between emotions and passions? I want to give a definition of a Stoic passion so we've got a clearer idea of precisely what it is that they think we ought to avoid. And I also want to mention a number of other things that the Stoics do not reject that might well fall under the broader English notion of emotion. I don't want to get too hung up on trying to define what the English word emotion means, and the fact that it's this kind of vague, woolly notion that is very difficult to define just adds to my point, I hope. So what I'm going to do now is distinguish between four different types of things that might, in a very general way, look like emotional responses. Four different types of things, only one of which the Stoics think we ought to overcome. So picking up on some points that have already been made. First of all, we might think about what I'll call emotions of affinity. So the Stoics say that each of us is born with an inherent natural instinct for our own self-preservation. And they also say that this instinct for self-preservation extends beyond ourselves. So we're naturally predisposed to care for our close family relations as well as ourselves, and if we develop into well-rounded, rational adults, we'll extend those circles of care or concern to include our neighbours and, ideally, to include all of humankind. So when we take an interest and concern in the well-being of others, we're acting according to a perfectly natural instinct, the Stoics suggest. When a mother puts her own well-being at risk for the sake of her child, she's doing the same. Now, the Stoics, of course, famously suggest that we ought to live a life in harmony with nature. And so these sorts of natural instincts will be part of an ideal Stoic life. Indeed, the Stoic ideal is not to close ourselves off from caring for others, as Chris has just been discussing. On the contrary, it's to expand our circle of concern, so that we care for not just those that happen to be nearest to us, but for everyone, everywhere. The claim that the Stoics are just indifferent to the well-being of others is false. So that's one type of thing that the Stoics aren't suggesting we overcome. The second thing I'll call emotions of shock. Part of the popular caricature of the Stoics is that they are completely unmoved by external events, a block of stone in the face of adversity, and that this is some kind of inhuman ideal or superhuman ideal to the point of being completely impossible. And this caricature was evidently already current in antiquity, because there's a story, and it's a story that I'll discuss in more detail in the workshop this afternoon. There's a story in which someone on a boat is surprised to see a Stoic philosopher reacting in apparent fear in the middle of a storm at sea. Now, the Stoics do not claim that the ideal person will be completely unmoved by events, like a block of stone. Instead, they fully acknowledge that we jump when there are sudden loud noises, we flinch when we think we might get hurt, we blush in embarrassing situations, we get pumped up on adrenaline in exciting or stressful situations, and so on and so forth. And all of these, the Stoics call first movements, or pre-passions, first movements in Seneca in particular. And the Stoics suggest that these are completely natural, unthinking, physiological responses to external events that are out of our control. And they will also be part of an ideal Stoic life because, of course, they're automatic natural responses and so part of any natural human life, and certainly a life in accordance with nature. Okay, so that's a second type of thing, some of which we might include under the label of emotion, but isn't something the Stoics think we ought to reject altogether. Let me move on to the third. Let me move on to passions proper, the things that the Stoics do think we ought to overcome. Now, for the Stoics, a passion is an emotional response to an external state of affairs based upon a value judgment. In this sense, it's something quite complex, even though for most people, they seem to be generated almost unconsciously. Let me give an example. If I hear a loud explosion and I jump and I hide behind the nearest wall, that's not an instance of the Stoic passion of fear. Instead, we might say that it's a first movement, a sudden response, perhaps combined with a response reflecting my natural instinct of self-concern and self-preservation. So a combination of types one and two that I've just mentioned. But it's not a Stoic passion proper because it's too quick and instinctive. Let me now give another example. If I hear that I might lose my job and I start to dwell on all of the negative consequences that such an event might lead to, then I start to get very anxious about the future. Even though I've not lost my job and nothing bad has actually happened to me at all. That would be a Stoic passion. A negative feeling about the future based upon a value judgment that something terrible is about to happen. Now, the Stoics, of course, think that we can overcome these kinds of negative responses by examining and challenging the values on the basis of which we make those value judgments. And they think that they can offer us arguments about what we should and should not value. And this is where the Stoics offer a distinctively philosophical therapy. Although the Stoics will recommend that we overcome negative emotions such as fear because they can be unpleasant and sometimes debilitating features of our lives, I think it's worth stressing that the real reason why the Stoics want to avoid those passions is because they're the product of mistakes. They're the product of mistaken value judgments, and no one wants to get things wrong. It's not a question of whether anger is a good or bad, pleasant or unpleasant feature of human life. The Stoics are going to want to argue that it's false, mistaken, wrong, the product of a judgment made according to a false set of values. So the Stoic attitude towards the passions is not one of their own personal temperament or preference, they happen to be somewhat unfeeling. Instead, it's a consequence of a series of philosophical arguments. The person who reacts to an event with an extreme passion has made a mistake and they need correcting. Let me try to give an example. Go back to my earlier example. If I'm anxious about losing my job, then I'm fearful because I've judged that something terrible might happen. I've judged that the loss of income will adversely impact on my ability to live a happy life. I have made that judgment holding the view that a certain level of material prosperity is necessary in order for me to be happy. That's the belief or value judgment that ultimately grounds the passion of fear in this particular case. Now, the Stoics will respond to this with a philosophical argument. They will ask the question whether material prosperity is in fact necessary for a happy life. And they'll point to counterexamples. People with very little who are perfectly content. People with very much who are thoroughly miserable. They will acknowledge that although it might be nice, preferable, much better to be wealthy rather than poor, these counterexamples show us that it's not necessary or sufficient to lead a happy life. You can be happy without it. And knowing that, we shall realise that our fear is unfounded. It is indeed perfectly possible to be happy even after losing one's job. And when we correctly judge that this is not a terrible thing, we shall not generate the negative passion of fear. Now, while avoiding the negative emotions, the negative passions, is a very welcome consequence of all of this, I think the most important point here is simply not making mistakes in our value judgments. So we've got to get the ethics, the philosophy right first. Okay, so that's passions. That's the third of the four things I want to talk about. The fourth thing that I'd like to say something about, I'll call these good passions. So far, I've talked about bad passions, unpleasant emotional experiences based on mistaken value judgments. And the Stoics also acknowledge what they call good passions, positive emotional responses that are based on correct value judgments. Now, in the last example, we saw the Stoics deny that wealth is good because it's possible to be miserable with it and happy without it. And part of their definition of a good is that it's something that always and necessarily benefits us. If it only sometimes benefits us, then it's not really good. And that sort of analysis applies to all external things, they suggest, which, although can benefit us sometimes, don't always and necessarily benefit us. The only thing they suggest that does always and necessarily benefit us is virtue, which we might gloss as an excellent, healthy state of mind. This is the only genuine good because this is the only thing that can guarantee our well-being or happiness. It's the only thing the absence of which will guarantee our misery. Okay, so with that in mind, a good passion is an emotional state produced by a positive value judgment that is not mistaken and therefore perfectly acceptable. If for the sake of argument, and this is just for the sake of argument, if I happen to possess an excellent, virtuous, healthy state of mind, and I judge this to be a good thing, then I shall be judging correctly because this virtuous state of mind is indeed good. And when I make such a judgment, I shall generate a positive passion, a good passion of, in this instance, joy, the Stoics suggest. So the ideal Stoic life is not one devoid of emotions or passions, far from it. Indeed, the life of the ideal Stoic will necessarily involve good passions of this sort, insofar as the ideal Stoic will indeed have an excellent, virtuous, healthy state of mind. And just to underline the point that I think should be clear already, the reason why these good passions are welcome and the others are not is that these good passions are the product of correct value judgments, correctly judging that something good is indeed present. Okay, so let me wrap things up. So I've talked about four different types of reactions to things, we might say, that the ancient Stoics considered and discussed, and that might fall under our usual thinking about emotions. And as we've seen, the Stoics suggest that we ought to overcome just one of these four types. The other three they acknowledge as part of an ideal human life: care and concern for others, natural human responses to sudden events, and positive passions based on correct judgments about what's most important in a human life. So the ideal Stoic life is far from unemotional in the English sense of the word. Indeed, what the Stoics propose we reject are not emotions in the English sense of the word at all. If emotions in English are defined as feelings that contrast with reasoning, instead, what the Stoics are proposing we reject is faulty reasoning based on a confused set of values and the unpleasant consequences that they generate. Thank you.
We have a few minutes for questions and answers. Perhaps, Chris, you might just take my place. I might go around with the microphone. Or perhaps.
Okay. Are these working?
Yeah.
Any
okay.
Questions or answers?
Just a quick one on the
Wait a minute. Hang on. Okay, is this mic working? Okay. I'm not sure actually whether they are that different.
One of the things I found out was that what's the difference?
Okay, let's have questions.
Yes, thank you. A lot of the different terms that are used to translate different emotional states, it is very complex. There's a complex history in the way in which some of those words have been turned into English words with slightly different meanings. And even in Cicero's book, The Tusculan Disputations, in which he discusses the Stoic theory of emotions, he has a lengthy introduction where he describes the way in which he's going to use certain Latin words to translate certain technical Greek words, and he explains the differences between the nuances between those different words. So there's already a problem of translation within the ancient Stoic tradition between Greek and Latin. And then the words that we imperfectly translate those terms into English creates another layer. So yes, linguistically can be quite complicated. Thank you.
To the point of correct and incorrect value judgments, a little bit worrying, I must say, because who is the judge? What is a correct value judgment and what is incorrect? We have a distinguished history of institutions that imposed what is correct and not correct when it comes to value judgments. So which passions we should reject and should not? Who decides?
Shall I
say something first?
Yeah, you say something.
Okay, so the Stoics will offer us a series of arguments as to why they think we should value some things and not others. And this is philosophy, it's not authoritarian. They present the arguments to you, you either find the arguments convincing or you don't.
So Stoicism isn't about giving rules, it isn't about experts giving rules to those below them. So they will say, why is it incorrect? Well, because it's a judgment. Say the example you had before, you're losing your job, okay? So you're losing money, okay? But you're not losing the capacity to develop virtue, to develop qualities that you can express even without that money. So that's an argument, and that's a general principle. And the Stoics will offer that principle to you with arguments. They won't tell you what you ought to be feeling. Does that help? There is.
Yeah.
You're right. Yes. It is a claim. It's not an authoritative claim. It's not like Hitler saying, I am the people. It's a philosophical claim that virtue is fundamentally more important. And of course, you can argue about them.
I'll just chip in one further comment on this, because I think it is an interesting and important point. I have this kind of image of ancient Athens as a kind of a philosophical marketplace where the Stoics set up their stall and offer a series of arguments trying to convince passers-by of what they think will be the way to live an ideal life. The Epicureans do the same, people in Plato's Academy do the same, and the budding philosophy student will shop around. He'll go and visit the different schools, and we have biographical accounts that this is what lots of people did. Zeno, who founds the Stoa, spent 10 years studying at Plato's Academy beforehand, and also studied with Megarian logicians and cynics, shopping around, looking for what he thought were the most convincing arguments. Ultimately, he didn't find any that were convincing, so he came up with his own. So this is one option that's presented to us, and it's for us to judge whether we think it's convincing or not. But no one's trying to insist we accept it on authority.
Yeah, you said about if you lose your job, then there's no need to worry because we can all be happy with a lot less. But if you're living on the streets, or if you're being sanctioned by the job centre, or if you're feeling suicidal because you can't work, I don't think that that's as good a life as it's not a question of leading a good life or a bad life. I don't think you can possibly. It sounded a bit dismissive to me. Oh, don't worry about losing your job. Never mind. You can be happy with a lot less. Yes, you can, but nothing at all. You've got to talk about basic survival. People need to survive.
Absolutely. I wouldn't say anything against that at all. And as I said in part of my talk, of course, it would always be preferable to be wealthier rather than poor, to be healthy rather than sick.
And preferable doesn't mean just, oh, I'd sort of like it rather than not. It's fundamentally natural for us as human beings to want to preserve ourselves, to do everything in our power to have an adequate material life. But there are some things in life which we can't, there are certain situations you have to accept. There come points where you can't do anything about it. At that point, Stoicism will say, well, what matters ultimately Is it the losing the job, or is it having the character and resources and resilience to endure that experience and every other? So it's when you go that further level, I think, that Stoicism can help.
I think maybe one of the problems here is, again, a question of translation. The word preferable is a standard English translation for a technical word in Greek. Preferable in English might sound a bit dismissive, so that might not create the best image, but yeah.
Oh, yeah. How do you define virtue? How do the Stoics define virtue?
Well, they defined it in various ways. I think the best way of understanding it is that those qualities, first of all, they're linked, they're interlinked, so they form a set, and they're those qualities that are essential to leading a good human life. They broke these down into four groups, really. Wisdom, courage, self-control, and justice, with a lot of subdivisions. But I think it's less that that matters than the idea that without them, it's hard to imagine what a good human life would be and how it would hang together in a coherent way.
Hello. This is for John. You were saying that Stoics criticize negative passions because they're based on a false judgment, a false value judgment. But can there not be a negative passion based on a true value judgment? For example, you're frightened of UKIP winning the election because you think it will be bad for society.
Okay. I don't want to current on contemporary British politics. The Stoics do talk about the good passion of caution, which would be a passion generated by the judgment that something genuinely valuable might be destroyed. So if you were virtuous and you were in a situation where you thought your virtue might be compromised, you would rightly judge that something terrible might be about to happen because you might lose the one thing that really is important. And they suggest that the passion that you would experience would be one of caution rather than fear. I would need to say a lot more to cash that out. But yes, there are emotional responses that are correct value judgments that pick up on the idea that something bad might actually happen. But it's going to be about the loss of virtue rather than the loss of anything external.
And there were, of course, like competing philosophical schools which thought there was more of a value in negative emotions, wasn't there? Like Aristotelianism. So if you want to shop around, Gabrielle is an expert in Aristotle. So, okay, I think we've got time for one last question. So I'm going to go down to this lady.
Yes, I'll try to be brief. Recently, a friend of mine, very close friend, had a catastrophic stroke. Okay, so she's alive. She can't speak, move, do anything, eat, anything. She's conscious. Now, obviously, that made me feel sad. That's normal. But I, as a Stoic, I can examine my judgments and therefore move on from that. I accept that. But what about a feeling which comes out of empathy? A negative feeling, a really very negative feeling when I look at the tears in her eyes and she can't communicate, or when her children are weeping, adult children, because they, because of their feelings and because they have no other family, so they're leaning on me. Now, presumably that's not a negative feeling when it's about somebody else through empathy. Presumably I cannot use is there anything one can do or should do?
Yes, that's a very good question. I suppose the thought would be that in the first of my four different types that I talked about, a natural concern for the well-being of other people is a perfectly natural response. I mean, this is the irony of it. The Stoics would say that the person who stands there like a block of stone when a friend of theirs goes through something like that, they would be acting unnaturally. The natural thing would be to express those feelings of care and concern. What distinguishes a natural feeling of concern and empathy in the English sense of the word from a negative passion in the Stoic sense is whether it becomes excessive or out of control. So one of the things that is constantly comes up in the definition of passions in the ancient Stoic literature is that if this is so out of control that it runs away from you and you can no longer keep it in check, that's the thing that needs to be avoided. And there's an analogy that Chrysippus uses where he says, well, if you're jogging and you need to stop and you can just stop, then that's fine. But if you're running downhill at breakneck speed and someone says stop, you can't stop. You're out of control. And a bad passion is like that, where it's become so excessive it's out of your control. And the example I often like to use is the example of a doctor. You want a doctor to be dispassionate in some sense, but caring and concerned about other people in another sense. He can be very empathetic, but it doesn't get out of control to the point that it stops him doing his job in an effective, rational way. So.
Okay, well, thank you. If you could join us for thanking Chris and John very much. So now, one of the things we wanted to emphasise in the event was not just Stoicism as something academic, but to get the balance between academic Stoicism, understanding the original context of these ideas, think about them clearly, but also the practical as well, how we today use these ideas in our lives, often to cope with difficult experiences, to heal our emotions, this kind of thing, which is going to be the focus of our next panel. But so I'm interested in people's kind of personal stories as well today. So I'm going to introduce you to Stephen Leeson, who is from Holland. He's come over here today. And Stephen has worked to support Stoicism and the Stoic community over the last few years. Shall I just hand you the mic, Stephen? Okay, so he's going to tell you a little bit about how he uses Stoicism.
I use Stoicism as a means to cope with autism. 10 years ago, I was diagnosed with autism spectrum, which describes a range of conditions classified as neurodevelopmental disorders. Throughout my life, I've had problems in social interaction, at school, and on the labor market. This led to a severe depression about 10 years ago and anxieties ever since. Luckily, I rediscovered Stoicism by coincidence at a very difficult moment in my life, and this philosophy has helped me ever since. In the early days, my knowledge of Stoicism was very limited. I was basically repressing emotions and ended up being Spock too much, you know, the Star Trek character, a lot of the time. But later on, I read the right books and blog posts, and this provided me with the knowledge I needed to put Stoicism in practice. Distinguishing between what is in our power and what is not, that is a technique that many people use without knowing it's a Stoic concept. It has proven to be very useful to me to conquer the crippling fears I sometimes experience. And another few other things that are helpful to me, the Stoic virtues, of course, which are nowadays called values, wisdom, courage, justice, and self-control. The concept of oikeiosis, which is in the Stoic handbook, so if you haven't read about it, you should. Stoic mindfulness and the notion of human brotherhood and our duties towards others. On a final note, Seneca wrote, to err is human, but to persist in it is diabolical. Yes. So that's why I'm a Procopton, a Stoic student who works towards progress, because it's better to make progress than to stand still or to regress.
Thank you very much, Steve. I think in the program it said two accounts, but we're going to actually do the, if you want to come to my workshop, we'll do more of these kind of interviews and stories in that. So we're going to take a break now.